we kind of go before asking, you know, you were a legendary sports journalist. You covered amazing stories. You were there during the Dream Team era and covered many more games after that and many more players. And you have amazing books, which we've mentioned. Is there any sports journalist or any media elite or anybody in the journalism field in sports that reminds you of yourself or that you're watching because you just genuinely respect their opinion?
Today's people are so different. There's so many people I respect. And, you know, my path to what I did in journalism, I mean, I'm a complete dinosaur. I mean, I started out at a small newspaper and got to Sports Illustrated because I sent them some clippings. And, you know, they liked them. And then I wrote some freelance stories and I got to SI on the basis of that. I mean, that path doesn't exist anymore. And somewhere there comes a point in your career, for me, it was at the Olympics in 2000, when you had to decide, was your best stuff going to go on the website or were you going to save it for the magazine? This became a really kind of crucial point for a lot of us who were older journalists who were used to saving up the material and taking 4 or 5 days to write it. And you didn't have to write it right away. So you could make it better. You could ask some questions that other journalists didn't have time for. I'm wending around to your question in a long way. So
no,
there was this point when you had to decide if you were going to join, you know, the new forces or just continue the way you always did it. And Sports Illustrated did not do a good enough job of joining the new way. Mm. You know, the website got off. I think it's a great website now, but it got off to kind of, you know, a slower start. And all of a sudden you woke up someday and there were people telling stories in a different way than you told them. I mean, Bill Simmons certainly changed the landscape for sports journalism. There was a guy from Sports Illustrated named Curry Kirkpatrick who used to write like Bill years ago. But it didn't have the same impact. Bill found a way to do it across many mediums. You mentioned Zach Lowe. Zach's ability to both plug in, you know, kind of sabermetrically and also tell the story is something I really, really admire. Chris Mannix kind of does the same thing. The Woj does the same thing. So when I was researching the book, the Warriors part of the book, those guys out there, Marcus Thompson, Tim Kawakami, Anthony Slater, they do such a good job with podcasts.
Yeah.
You know, that in fact, you know, I'm even trying to think about doing one next week and what we're doing right now. There's so many different ways to tell a story. And I came up when there was only one way. You know, you right. told it with this long kind of magazine way. And I was fortunate enough to be able to do it in books also. But I really admire the people that are finding new ways to tell stories.
Right. And real quick, I think what, at least for me on a personal level, what I really admired about your writing was you never really detoured people from thinking a certain way, or you never forced them to think about ideas that you wanted them to think about. You kind of planted a new vision from a new angle, and we were able to really see things from a completely different perspective as opposed to forced media. There's a lot of forced media these days, and you're forced to really think about one thing, and you really did a great job at kind of clearing people's minds, getting in there, planting a new idea, and letting it evolve naturally.
Well, I came up in an era when, you know, for me, everything, the tightrope that I worked, not just me, but people from my era, the tightrope that we walked was access. The more access you got, the better your story was, the deeper it was. But the more access you get, the closer you get to an athlete, you know. And we're kind of like human beings. If somebody lets you in and likes you,
right,
your writing would tend to kind of go that way. And I was fortunate, A, and I think walked that tightrope pretty well between people letting me in and liking me okay, but still kind of telling the truth. But B, being fortunate enough to come along in an era when athletes understood not everything was going to be positive. Right. You know, Magic Johnson, Larry Bird came into a league that was dying. And part of their covenant with the league was that they were going to help to sell it. And part of the thing that they, you know, part of that was they had to talk to schlubs like me. And that kind of became the paradigm. Even Michael paid attention to it. Guys, now it's a little bit different. They're very sophisticated about their own media. We talked about it a couple minutes ago. They have their own platforms. You know, they have Players Tribune. They have their own websites. They have their own Twitter feeds. They have a way of breaking their own stories. So when you get, and we're really fortunate now because I think guys like Steph Curry and Kevin Durant, who are very, very sophisticated about their own platforms, also understand that you need to extend at least a pinky finger, you know, to people like me in the media. And I think right now the NBA has always been a great league, has always been a media-friendly league more than anything else. I don't think people understand the degree to which that is true. And I was very fortunate to have been covering that sport because I tell you, it wouldn't have been as easy in other sports. It's just not the same thing.